हेलो एंड वेलकम टू ऑल माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू जीसी टेक हब सीएस ट्यूटोरियल्स। इन टुडेज लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू डील विद नेस्टेड लूप्स। सो इन आवर प्रीवियस लेक्चर्स वी हैड स्टडीड विद अ लॉट मेनी डिफरेंट कॉन्सेप्ट्स, दैट इज सिलेक्शन स्टेटमेंट्स, दैट इज इफ स्टेटमेंट, नेस्टेड इफ स्टेटमेंट, कैस्केडिंग इफ। Then we studied looping, iteration, and we got introduced to two different types of loops, while loop and for loop. And we understood how iteration works. But sometimes we also need to perform an iteration within an iteration. So that gives rise to looping within looping, and that is your nested loops. So in today's class, we are going to deal with one such topic, that is nested loops. So students, the program which I am going to demonstrate today, I will be telling it to you using two ways. One way is the traditional way, the traditional method, which is followed by many other programming languages, especially C and C++ based languages like C, C++, Java, JavaScript, PHP, and so on. So all these languages, they follow the syntax, the common syntax of C language. So we are going to first see it with respect to a traditional programming language, like how such a program is done in a traditional language. And we are also going to see the exclusive Python way of coding such programs. Why we are doing this? Because it is not necessary that you will only stick to Python. In future, you may also switch to other platforms like Java, or even C++ is considered a very good platform for learning programming and clearing concepts and building logic even to this day. So you may think of switching to some other platform other than Python. So at that time, you should also know how to work with nested loops in that environment where you might not get the exclusive Python constructs to code such programs. So we will understand the two different ways in which we can create a Python program involving nested loops. And the best way to understand nested looping is to take up such topics, is to understand it through pattern printing. So pattern printing is considered as the base of nested looping. If you really want to clear your concepts regarding nested loops, pattern printing is the best way to do that. So we are going to see one pattern printing program, and we are also, if time allows us, we will also see another program which involves nested looping. So let's move on to today's class. So this is what we are going to discuss today. We will be seeing nested loops. And within that also, we are going to start with the nesting of while loops, and we will discuss these two programs. First program is a program to print all prime numbers between 1 and 100, and the second program is to print the following pattern on the screen. So let's move on. First of all, we will understand the basic structure and syntax of nested loops. So let's move on to our Python script window. So the first thing is, we are going to see the syntax of while loop, of nested while loop. So nested while loop syntax goes like this: initialization one, or we can say initialization of loop of variable one, which is the loop control variable one. Initialization of variable 1 and while condition 1, which is my outer loop, followed by statements, if any, if there are statements. So I'm going to represent them using this colon mark. Then initialization of variable 2, while condition 2, which is my nested while loop, while inside while. Then we can have some statements here also. And followed by update expression 2, then followed by, again I can have some statements over here, and then I can have update expression 1. So you can see very well over here. I will just take a screenshot of this. So this is how it looks like. So over here, first is the initialization of loop control variable 1. Variable 1 and variable 2, these are loop control variables. That is variables which control the execution of the loop. So this inner block, it is your inner while loop, and this is your outer while loop. So this is how, and you can also have even have a loop inside this second while loop. That would just go on increasing the levels of looping inside the program. Now students, you should keep one thing in mind, that when the outer loop iterates once, the inner loop will complete its cycle. When the outer loop executes once, the inner loop is going to complete its cycle. For example, if variable 1 has to take up 5 values, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it will execute for one time, and while it executes once, variable 2 is going to complete its cycle. Whatever is the stopping point, maybe it is 6, maybe it is 7, maybe it is n, any number. So variable 2 is going to complete its cycle while variable 1 is only there stuck at one value. Next iteration, variable 1 will be incremented by 2, by 1, once variable 2 has already completed its one cycle. So when variable 1 becomes 2, variable 2 will again start its cycle from 1, and it will end at the stopping point. After this, again variable 1 will increment by 1, and variable 2 will again start its cycle. So this is how a nested loop works, where for every one iteration of the outer loop, the inner loop completes its cycle, its entire cycle. So we will be seeing this with the help of one program, that is, write a program in Python to print all the prime numbers between 1 and 100. So let me just copy this. And let us first write a pseudocode to solve this question. So first step is start. Second step is we need to print all the prime numbers between 1 and 100. Now we had already seen before that in Python or any programming language, if you are writing a program for printing prime numbers. So prime numbers, what is the logic which we are following? That is, we already know that prime numbers are all those numbers which are divisible by 1 or the number itself. So we check whether the number is getting divided by any number in between, like from 2 to n minus 1. If the number is divisible by any of these numbers, that means it is not a prime number, it is a composite number. So we had written a program earlier using while loop, using a single loop to check whether a number is prime or not. Now we are going to use that same logic in this program, and we will code the program in such a way that it will give us a list of all the prime numbers in between 1 and 100. So let us do it and see. So we will first start with initialize i by 1. So we will start I from 1. We can also start from 2 because 1 is not considered as a prime number. So we are, let us start this from 2. That would be better. So we start I from 2. Then next we have to run a loop, and so we are going to just start. There could be a lot many changes here. That is because we are writing a pseudocode. That is, we are concentrating on the logic of the program. So logic of a program might keep changing from time to time until we hit upon the correct best possible logic. So I might be doing a lot of hit and trial over here. So kindly watch me very patiently. So I'm going to write here, if I is less than equal to 100, then go to step 4. Otherwise go to step X. So we will determine what is step X a little later. So now if I is less than equal to 100, we say that go to step 4. Now what should be there in step 4? In step 4, now we have to check whether a number is prime number, whether I is prime number or not. So we will have to run a loop from 2 to I minus 1. So now we will initialize another value j, and we will start it from 2. Then if j is less than I, now we have taken less than I here, then go to step 6. Otherwise, go to step y. So we will see what is there in step Y later. So we will see here in step 5, if J is less than I. So this is the part where we check whether I is divisible by J or not. So we write here, if I is divisible by J, then go to step 7. Otherwise, go to step 8. So here also we will write step set so that we can figure it out a little later. So now it is, if I is divisible by J, go to step 7. So if I is divisible, it means that I is not a prime number. It is a composite number. So that means we need to do nothing over here, and we need to just continue with the iteration for the next statement. So we are not going to do anything in this case. If I is divisible by J, then go to step A. Otherwise, go to step B. So we are just fixing these values as A and B because we don't know yet which step we need to go. So we are going to write the next step as, now we know that if I is divisible by J, that means it is not a prime number. So in this case, we don't need to take any step. We don't need to do anything. Simply, we need to go to the next iteration of the outer while loop. So we are not going to see that right now. We are just assuming that everything is going fine and I is not divisible by J. In that case, we just need to update the value of J. So we will write update J equals J plus 1. And once we do this, go to step 5. And our ninth step would be, we are going to write here, if I is equal to J, that is, if J is equal to I, then go to step 10. Otherwise, go to step something like step K. So step 10 would be, if in case J is equal to I, means J has, we have been dividing I by J, and we did not come across any such number which is between, we didn't come across any value between 1 and I through which I is divisible. Okay, so that means I reaches J, that is, sorry, J reaches I, And when J reaches I, it is clear that the number has only two factors, one and the value I itself. So in this case, we will simply print the value of I, which is a prime number, and we will update the value of I, update I equals I plus 1, and we will go back to step 5. That is the, sorry, not step 5, but step 3, which is the outer loop. Now let's figure out these statements. So we will be going to that loop, and 13 statement would be stop because we don't need to do anything over here. Now let's start with this. If J is equal to I, then we go to step 10, update the value of I and go back to step 3. If it is not so, then we will simply be going back to step, we'll be going to step 11. That is, we won't print the value of I. We will skip step 10. Just go to step 11, increment the value of I and go back to step 3. That's what we are going to do over here. So now after this, what we are going to do is we are coming to step 6, where we had step A. If I is divisible by J, then go to step A. That is, if I is divisible by J, it means it is a composite number, so we don't need to display it. So we will directly be jumping to step 11. We don't need to execute any of these steps, and we will be jumping to step 11. And if it is not divisible, if in case it is not divisible, then proceed as usual. So we will be going to step 7. If J is less than I, then go to step 6. Otherwise, go to step 5. That means if your loop, if the value of J is still less than I, then go to step 6 and continue the loop. Otherwise, we need to terminate the loop. So for that, we will be going back to step 9 over here to check whether J is equal to I or not. And one more we have, that is, if I completes its iteration till 100, that means it's time for our program to terminate. So we'll be going to step 13, which is stop. Let's do a simple dry run of this code and see how it works. So when we do a dry run, we are taking a number, we are taking I initialized as 2. So if I is less than equal to 100, answer is yes. Go to step 4. So we go to step 4, initialize J by 2. Now if J is less than I, so is J less than I, answer is false. So we will directly go to step 9. J is not less than I, so we will just directly go to step 9 over here. This is step 9. If J is equal to I, so yes, J is equal to I, then go to step 10. So step 10 is print I, that is 2. And update the value of I by 1, so I now becomes 3. Then go to step 3, so we go to step 3 over here. Is I less than 100? Yes. Go to step 4 again, J is initialized by 2. If J is less than I, yes, J is 2, which is less than I. Go to step 6. So we will go to step 6 over here. So this is step 6. Is if I is divisible by J. So I is 3. It is not divisible by J, which is 2. So we will go to step 7. That is this step 7. Update J equals J plus 1. So now we update the value of J. We make it as 3. Go to step 5. So we go to step 5. Is J less than I? No. Now J is equal to I. So go to step 9. So we are at step 9. If J is equal to I, yes, they are equal. Go to step 10 and print I. So we print the value, that is 3. Update I. I becomes 4. Go to step 3. Now I is still less than equal to 100, so we again go to step 4, initialize J by 2. So J again starts from the value, that is 2. If J is less than I, yes, J is 2, I is 4, so J is less than I. Go to step 6. Is I divisible by J? Yes. Now 4 is divisible by 2. So go to step 11. So we go to step 11 directly over here. because it is not a composite number, so we directly go to step 11, and here we find an update statement where I gets incremented by 1, and go to step 3 and start it for the next number, that is 5. So we again initialize j by 2. Is j less than I? Yes. Go to step 6. Is I, that is 5, is it divisible by 2? Answer is no. So go to step 7, update the value of j, make it 3. Go to step 5. Is j less than I? Yes. Again, go to step 6. Is I divisible by j? Answer is no. Again, go to step 7, update the value of j. It becomes 4. Go to step 5. Is 4 less than I? Yes. Go to step 6. Is 5 divisible by 4? Answer is no. Again, go to step 7. Increment the value of j. Go back to step 5. Is j less than I? Answer is no. So now we go to step 9. Is if j is equal to I? Yes, j is equal to I. Go to step 10. Print I. So we will be printing the value, that is 5. Go to step 3. So now this way the program will continue till the number 100. So our logic is correct. Now we will quickly code the program. So I have already coded the program over here, but I'll do it once again. So we start I by 1, and let me keep the pseudo code also in front. So this is my pseudo code, and I'm going to hide it within block comments. So we start i equals 2, while I is less than equal to 100, we will be going to step 4, that is initialize j by 2. Then we will check while j is less than I, that is our step 5. We go to step 6 if it is true. So we again check the condition if I is divisible by j or not. If that is so, then we use a break statement which directly makes a jump to, like we can see over here, we directly makes a jump to step 11, that is the next iteration. So it will break the inner while loop. It will come out of the inner while loop and it will go to the next statement. So within this while loop, that is if the condition is false, if this condition is false, then we will be incrementing the value of j as usual. And once it comes out of the while loop, we will check the condition of step 9. If j is equal to I, if that is so, we will be printing the value of I, which is a prime number, and we will be updating the value of I regardless of whether it is a prime number or not. And this concludes our program. So we will just run the program and see, and you can see it prints all the prime numbers between 1 and 100. So this is one example of a nested loop which we just saw over here. The second program, I'll be recording this in my next lecture. So this is the first part of it. The second program we'll be seeing in the second part of this lecture. Otherwise, this video will become too long for you people. So this is one program involving nested loops. So please follow this program and try to solve as many questions as you can which involve nested loops. And this was the first part of this video, and in the next part of the video I will be showing you the pattern printing program. So thank you everybody. See you again in the next class.